You may be surprised to see predictability as a negative attribute of offences, and to some extent, a team being predictable is necessary, otherwise it would be really hard to know where to move and where to throw. To use an ultimate cliché, it's important that both offences and defences are on the same page. But in this video, I hope to convince you that offences should mask this predictability under a veil of chaos to avoid other teams preempting and interrupting your plan. Ultimate is obsessed with set plays. Ultimate was derived from American football, and this has meant that the language and the tactics of football are cemented into the sport. Like in activity, predictability is a concept within all team sports. American football teams attempt to minimize offensive predictability by having extensive playbooks so that week to week the defense won't know what's going to happen until it's happening. And American football is also obsessed with exploiting unaccounted for predictability. Take a look at this 2013 Advanced Scouting Report, which goes into minute detail about reads of the Denver Broncos offense. And it's not just American football. Andre Agassi talks here about how he could read which direction Boris Becker would serve in based on the position of his tongue.
And just as he was about to toss the ball, he would stick his tongue out. If he's serving in the deuce court and he put his tongue in the middle of his lip, he was either serving up the middle or to the body. But if he put it to the side, he was going to serve out wide.
Ultimate is conversely unbothered by offensive predictability. If you've ever played a game where your team has been beaten by the same person or the same cuts time and time again, then you'll be well aware that Ultimate defenses are poor at exploiting offensive predictability. There are occasional moments of individual brilliance in reading the play, like this poach D from Alan Kolick we saw in the last video.
Oh, and a good poach there, well timed.
Lisa Pekathley's poach D from Pro Championships.
Very physical, athletic player.
And it's not just poached D's, check out Valeria Cardenas' huck preventing prediction point book.
And Revere's throw just swatted down.
And Johnny Bansfield's prediction of a swing that never comes. If Ultimate coaches, captains, and strategists do want to minimize offensive predictability, then one approach would be to take a leaf out of American football's book and design dozens of elaborate set plays, a mechanical approach to Ultimate. Ignoring the current practical challenges of pulling this off, I think that there are structural reasons why set plays are less valuable in Ultimate. Firstly, there's only one uniform situation in Ultimate, and that's a brick. If a set play doesn't result in a score immediately, the offense still faces the same challenge of organically progressing the disc up the field. And here's why that initial set play won't work that well either, because discs are slower than balls, and that means that every Ultimate set play is one deep poach away from losing a lot of value. To clarify, set plays are less valuable, not completely lacking in value. A set play can still be useful to complete the first pass from a static situation and get the offense moving. Here's Stevens Tech playing Hex and opening up the play by rotating the hat, wing, and back. Stevens uses this set play quite a few times throughout this game, so if the opposition recognized this, they could exploit it. Taking you all the way back to episode 0, remember the positional advantage and the initiation advantage. Knowing what the offense is going to do takes away both advantages, so we can act abnormally as defenders to exploit the play. An obvious thing the defenders could do here would be to stand still and wait for the attackers to run to them. This would be sustained poaching. Another option could be flash poaching. The defender who starts in the hat space could track towards the sideline and then dart back to the middle to beat the cutter to the space. If you pick exactly the right time, you get the D. Go too late and the cutter gets the disc anyway. Go too early and the thrower takes the throw to the wide open player on the wing. Watch out for rotation in set plays. It's a key tactic that lots of teams use to make their individual set play cyclical. This means they treat every individual possession of the disc as a set play and basically behave the same every time. A great example of this is Revolver's side stack. Revolver hyper-isolate a player in space who attempts to get free deep, then attempts to get free under, and then when they rarely do not get free, they clear laterally to rejoin the front of the stack. If the player gets free deep, they are thrown to for the score. If they get free under, after the throw, the previous thrower becomes the dump, and the dump rejoins the front of the stack. If the isolated player doesn't get free, or the pass doesn't go, then the dump is engaged, at which point everything gets complicated and I'm not going to bother going into it. Here's the revolver movement decision tree. Obviously, all movement decision trees are deliberate oversimplifications. At a glance, the hex and revolver decision trees look pretty similar, but the fact that revolver's offense prescribes offensive movement makes the path of the disc considerably easier to predict than hex. Watch them play and see how early you can predict where the disc is going. A lot has been written about revolver's offense, and if you want to learn more, I've linked some UltiWorld articles in the description. Here's what you won't hear in those articles though. From the offensive mistakes perspective, revolver's offense is terrible. We've got clustering, inactivity, predictability, and some occasional crossovers. Hopefully, through the series, you'll have thought about the tactics you can use to exploit all of these inefficiencies, and you'll have to use a lot of them in order to match revolver's athleticism and disc skills. Chasing Antoine Davis. Let's have a quick look at what Pony did in the 2018 thrashings against revolver in Pro Champs and US Nationals. Pony understands that the most common option is for the deepest attacker to get the disc in this sort of space. So Pony players marking inactive players keep their heads up and flash poach into the lane ahead of the revolver cuts. This remains the best example of a team exploiting events of inactivity and predictability to help them cause turnovers. Check out Felix's analysis and the full game in the description. A final word on predictability. Creating a system that is predictable to your teammates is necessary, as it simplifies the decision process for where to cut and which throws to prepare and to look for. But at the very least, offenses must be perceived as unpredictable, because eventually you're going to run into a team who knows what you're going to do and will stop you before you can do it. It's one of the reasons Hex has the Hex Movement Decision Tree, which is a set of principles which an offense can learn and implement to get on the same page. I hope for a lot of people this series will get the Hex cogs turning in your mind. Hex minimizes clustering, inactivity, and predictability, so defenses struggle to find something to consistently exploit. Thanks for watching this series. If you'd like to support the channel and get access to the director's cut of these videos, along with the Discord, livestream archive, early access to the YouTube videos, training videos, and so much more, please become a patron at patreon.com/hiveultimate. It's linked in the description below. Without further ado, I'll see you all soon.
Teams yet to find a good response to the fluid movement of the Colombian adaptation of the Hex offense.